Welcome to the Port Charlie Podcast, everybody. I am your host, Gomer the Ranting Thespian, and my co-host this week, as always, is...
Hello, I am Namio.
Hooray! And my very first question is, Luke, what the fuck?
The first thing I was gonna say is, ding dong, the bitch is gone, finally, so...
Yeah...
But yeah, Luke, what the fuck is a good close second.
Because his particular strain didn't take a lot of time this week, so... And it's kind of detached from most everything else.
Well, you know, Luke hasn't seemed right ever since he came back from Miscavige. And I wondered if maybe they, you know, discharged him a little soon. He's been walking around... almost like he's still stoned.
Yeah, it's like very out of character for him. Especially this week when he just laid into Monica after proposing to Tracy. It was just,
Dude, okay,
when you have Tracy Quartermain on your ass saying, bitch, calm the fuck down, you got issues.
I have to ask, you're more familiar with the history of this show. Was what he was saying about Monica right?
To a degree, yes. He might have exaggerated a little bit, but Monica, when she was married to Alan, she was messing around with Rick Weber. And among other dudes over her tenure on the show, all while supposedly being married to Alan. So, yeah, she is a bit of an adulteress. She has been that in her day. And it's just, and the trigger for that is just Luke and Tracy told her the news, and Monica's just like, what the really? He's after your money, and Luke just loses it and tears into her. I mean, it's like it's one thing to like trade barbs and everything, because that's how the Quartermains show their affection, apparently. You know, trading barbs back and forth, that's one thing, but what Luke did, and looking back and reviewing it and everything, it was a lot mean-spirited. It's like, dude, out of character moment, what the fuck?
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, wow. And the timing could not have been worse because, you know, at the end of last week, AJ went and confronted Ava. And today we get to see the results of him confronting Ava, who basically confesses it all to him and is about to shoot him. But somehow he...
She did... She pulled the trigger, and the gun didn't fire, conveniently.
Yeah.
And so he's like, and it's kind of funny, because, you know, they're standing, like, 2 feet apart from each other. Like, AJ could have tried to knock the gun out of her hand, but he just stays there and is like, and is like, ready to wet himself, because he's like, I'm gonna die! And then when the gun doesn't fire, he's like, oh, wait, I can defend myself.
Yeah.
Well, and that's when he goes for the gun.
Yeah. Which, to be fair, to be fair towards AJ, put yourself in that position. Would you really be willing to to get shot in a worse place to defend yourself? Wouldn't you? I mean, I don't know about you, but I would probably
also... She was
also...
gonna kill him.
Yeah.
She told him she was going to kill him. I don't think there's much... you don't have a whole lot to lose by fighting back at that point.
True, but there's also fear. For whatever reason, fear is like paralyzing at times, and that's an understandable thing. It's a human thing. Yes, we I admit I will agree with you. Yeah, he could have fought back. We know this as viewers of the show. But in character, he's probably sitting there, remind you, half drunk, out of his mind.
Yeah.
So
I was gonna say he was drunk, so I guess that probably counts for something. But
yeah, so
but
so it's like drunkenness with a healthy dose of fear.
Of course, Ava did have a point though. She commented that AJ seems to have no sense of self-preservation, and she might be onto something there.
Yeah, I think that seems to have been the way over the years. You know, just. You know, when things get bad, he falls off the wagon. You know, I don't care, nobody cares, rah, 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 you know?
Nobody likes me, everybody hates me.
Yeah,
I'll go eat some worms at the bottom of a tequila bottle.
Mm-hmm, pretty much. And, And that's what makes this whole train with AJ a lot more tragic, because he's been trying to pull himself out of it. And then he gets knocked back into it, and it's just all the more tragic. Because yeah. You've seen him become a better man. He can be better.
Although, you know, he had to start drinking again because the alcohol was his magic memory juice.
Well, no, see, the thing is, he started drinking before Connie
died.
That's
true. And then he started figuring out that alcohol is his magic memory juice. That is true.
Yes.
I am getting my plot lines out of order.
Oh, that's okay. It's 50 years. Everybody does it.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
But, oh, so, you know, AJ knocks the gun out of Ava's hand, and he kind of goes ballistic, gets her against the wall, and starts strangling her.
Which, I will admit, is more deserved than when he tried to strangle Connie.
That's very true. And he's like, you know, you watched me suffer for months. You let everybody in my life, including me, believe that I was a murderer when all along it was you, you know.
Yeah. Everything. And, you know, basically, he gave her a really big, what the fuck, you bitch.
And, you know, he was going to kill her. I mean, for all his talk of not being a killer, like, I have a hard time believing that he would have stopped himself at that point, which
yeah.
makes AJ kind of stupid. But meanwhile, Sean has been,
he's been staking
chasing.
Out.
Yeah, he's been staking out Ava and Julian's apartment, trying to find out who Julian's partner, you know, backer is, which they're still, like, they still keep teasing that it's probably Rick, but they're not actually telling us that yet, and I'm like, if it is, I don't know why you're trying to keep it a secret,
mm-hmm.
and if it's not, this is kind of stupid, but whatever. you know, I think both is it just Michael or was it Morgan too, who had came to Sonny and asked him, you know, did you have anything to do with the break-in?
Oh, I think they both did.
And Sonny's like, no, it wasn't me.
Yeah. No. It's Michael came to Sonny for the break-in, and then Morgan asked Sonny about AJ. You know,
okay,
the
that's
direct
right.
One. Because, okay. Because thanks to Sean casing out the joint, he's able to tell Sonny that AJ was there. And so Sonny went over to see what was up. And
yeah.
That's...
left his gun behind on purpose to make sure that he would not be tempted to hurt AJ because he's very committed to keeping his promise to Michael.
Mm-hmm.
And then he gets there, finds the door open, finds AJ strangling Ava, and there just happens to be a gun on the floor. And, you know, he starts having flashbacks to when AJ was choking Connie.
Mm-hmm.
And just kind of enraged, you know, AJ lets go of Ava, and he's like, okay, dude, you don't understand, it's not what you think, I wasn't gonna kill her, which I think is total bullshit, and he's like, you know, I didn't kill Connie, and that's what really pisses Sonny off, and he pulls the trigger, and this time, because it is dramatically convenient, the gun does go off.
Yes, right into AJ's chest.
Yes.
At damn near point-blank range.
Yep.
And somehow, so far, AJ has survived. Oh, jeebus. Well, then again,
yeah.
He has come back from the dead at least once, so, you know.
Yeah.
So he is more of a fighter than he likes to let on, and other people like to imagine.
No, and that's despite Ava's best efforts, because she's like, no, really, Sonny, you need to kill him now. She's not willing to pull the trigger herself, apparently. At least not while there's a witness.
Yeah. But yeah, she's going to have Sonny do it when there's a witness there, uh-huh.
Yeah.
Because...
And so, yeah.
But no, they just leave it there. Ava wipes the prints off and leaves it there next to AJ. They get the hell out of there. And coming from his mystery associate... who we only see from the associate's point of view at this point, no dialogue from said person, He comes in to find AJ on the floor, like, what the hell? And so Julian, it's both stupid and smart at the same time.
Yeah.
Stupid because he gets his prints on the gun, but smart because he has no idea if whoever shot AJ was still in the apartment and could come after him.
Yeah.
With our out-of-character knowledge, it's stupid, but with his in-character knowledge, it's, you know, logical. If that makes any sense there.
Yes, it does. And, you know, I really have to give it to Ava. I mean, she is fucking brilliant. Because, you know, she's the one who, you know, looked at Sonny and said, you know what, trust me, and we will get out of this, basically. And so, you know, like you said, she wipes the gun and leaves it next to AJ, knowing that Julian is coming back.
Mm-hmm.
And that Julian didn't know that she was back in town, because as far as anybody knew, she was still in New York. And so she leaves the gun there, hoping that exactly, you know, what happened would happen, and knowing that someone had probably heard the gunshot and already called the police. And sure enough, you know, Julian, like you said, grabs the gun and is looking around the apartment, and just as the police come in and find him over AJ's body holding a gun.
Yeah, it doesn't look good for Julian, does it?
Ava tried to tell Julian, or not Julian, tried to tell Sonny that that might happen, and say, you know, if we play our cards right, you know, we'll take care of two birds with one stone, AJ and Julian. You know, she went back to New York, and she's, you know, basically told him, get yourself an alibi, I'll take care of mine, it'll be okay.
Mm-hmm. And turns out Sonny, he's still looking around for an alibi. Sean can't do it, because, you know, that would just be a massive no.
Well, Sean was at Kelly's while it was happening, and a lot of people saw him there, so he can't be Sonny's alibi.
That's right. But there is one person who was conveniently working at the warehouse all night long. Mr. Lavery. Old Duke. Yep. And Sonny's like, well, you just gotta say I was with you all night, man. And, of course, Anna comes into question Sonny, finds Duke there, and she asks Duke about Sonny's whereabouts last night.
Yes, and Cliff Friday cliffhanger, we don't know yet what he's gonna say, because, you know, and the thing about Sonny is, you know, he is an honorable person, and he looked Duke straight in the eye and he said, you know, if you don't want to do this because you're afraid that it will, you know, further endanger your relationship with Anna, just let me know. You know, basically, you know, you don't, I would like you to do this for me if you're willing, but if you're not, that's okay. I mean, you don't see many mob bosses who are that courteous.
No, not at all. It's like, you do this for me or else we're going to fit you with some new shoes.
Yes.
And if you want to get an idea of what those shoes would be like, play Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time and grab the iron boots. That's pretty much what you got there. I'd love to see in some kind of fiction, some kind of mob death that uses the like fashions a set of the iron boots from Ocarina of Time and uses that to off one of their enemies. That would be kind of interesting. I mean, granted, they would still be able to move around, but they can't get out. Unless, you have to do it right, but... God, that is definitely disturbing there. And, of course, this week, you know, between everything, you know, the alibi and everything, he's sitting there like, oh my God, I broke my promise to my son. And I'm sitting there thinking, yeah, you know what... I feel a little for him, but at the same time, it's like, no. I can't feel much for him on that one.
Well, and it's going to be interesting to see what happens, because, you know, my thought about that was, you know, yeah, Michael might be upset, but you know what? if AJ wakes up and he is able to tell Sonny the truth, I'm pretty sure that AJ would forgive Sonny.
Yeah.
And, you know, convince Michael to do the same.
Yeah, because it was literally heat of the moment. And I will admit, one reason why I find it very hard to feel for Sonny is because of his attitude towards AJ. And I'm sorry, you know, yeah, you made a promise to your son, you broke that promise, and, you know, yeah, I feel bad for you, pat, pat, pat on the back. But at the same time, even though you promised you weren't going to hurt him, you took, I mean, how many opportunities did he take to just talk down about AJ, whether Michael was around or not? You know, always thought the worst of him, and granted, he's had years of experience around the guy, and some of it may be justified, but this is a man who's been trying to make his life better, and granted, he fell off the wagon, he slipped back a bit, but, you know, instead of being there, instead of saying, you know what, at least for my son, I will help you out, I will do this and that for you, but no, you know, he can't do that. And it doesn't help that Connie was framing AJ. Not Connie. Ava.
Ava.
Yeah, Ava was framing AJ, so...
Well, to be fair, I mean, Sonny doesn't know the whole story. He only knows the ugly parts of AJ. And he still has every reason to believe that AJ did kill Connie. So, you know, I can see it from both sides.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And speaking of Ava in New York, Silas and Sam, yes!
they had a badass moment, damn!
Yeah, they go to try and visit his wife, Nina.
Yes.
And of course he's like, well, we can't let you in. And so they infiltrate it by walking around the hallways. Two guards say, hey, you have your visitor's pass? And then they make like, oh, do I have it? Did you leave it in the car? You left it in the car, blah, 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 blah. And they start having this like couple spat. One of the guards goes up to Sam, and eventually Sam just says, you know what, fuck it, and just, boom, kicks him right in the gut. They knock the guards out, get the car keys, make it up to Nina's room, and Silas walks in and finds nothing.
Yes.
Absolutely nothing. And after this revelation, they're let out, and he's believing that Nina is dead, which is pretty sad.
Well, it's really weird because, you know, meanwhile, Robin's, you know, parade of goodbyes continues. You know, Emma and Patrick have a little going away party for her, and it's all sad and touching and whatever. And, you know, finally Victor comes to get her and takes her away, and they come to the same building where, you know, Nina was supposed to be. And this is the point where I'm like, come the fuck on. Okay? Because, like, I understand needing to write her out. Mm-hmm. I get it. But it needs to make some sort of sense in the context of the story. And this place that, you know, Victor was taking her to is just right in New York City. She could fucking commute. There's no reason why she had to be taken away from her family. All she had to do was say, I got this fancy new job doing, you know, top secret research, and I signed, you know, an ironclad NDA, and that's why I can't talk about it.
Yeah, that in hindsight, Victor, you're part of the trio that tried to take over the world. What happened, dude?
Like... And I, like, just from a writing standpoint, I'm like, there are so many better ways they could have done that. And, like, mm-hmm. unless they, you know, then move somewhere overseas, I'm calling bullshit on the whole you have to leave your family thing.
Yeah. Which I'm willing to bet that's probably what's going to end up happening.
I don't know. It's hard to say, but surprise, surprise, you know, she did find Jason in the room across from where Nina was supposed to be. Ooh, you know, Victor Cassadine brings her in and shows her, and she says it's Jason, but we don't get to see him because they haven't paid the actor for it. So,
pretty much. And here's the question that I have, though. If Nina was moved and not and she didn't die, like Silas is fearing, you know, where did the WSB move her? Or what did they pay her family to move her? You know?
Yeah, and why? I don't know.
Why
there's
this
obviously
facility
more...
in New York City? My first guess is it's owned by the Cassidines. And I'm almost willing to bet that Nina has some connection with the Cassidines. That's something that's been kind of lulling around in my brain the past week. Nina is a Cassidine in some way, shape, or form. Which is going to be really awkward considering he's dating a Cassidine.
I don't know. They're obviously, like, going to make this, you know, super intriguey and complex and conspiracy theory. You know, it's one of those things where, you know, the real twist would be if Silas did try to kill her and is just trying to cover. I mean, that the most straightforward thing is the thing that would be the most surprising.
Yeah, I can definitely agree with that one. Although, I have to wonder, who was it that was walking up to Silas and Sam at Ryan's?
Who knows?
I don't think we got an answer for that yet.
When they do shit like that, it just makes me irritated because it doesn't make me curious. It just makes me annoyed, but, you know, that's just me.
Yeah, well, then again, what was it? The last time they did this that wasn't cliffhangery of any way? No,
yeah.
The last time they did this that was cliffhangery in any way, we got fucking Heather.
Yeah.
It's like, God damn it, Heather. Go back, go, you know, stay in prison, rot in prison with your BLTs from Kelly's. I swear.
You know, they haven't actually said where Heather went, because I would hope they wouldn't send her back to Miss Cabbage.
No, or if they did, they would replace the entire staff.
Fucking hope so. Yeah. Whatever.
That is one of those things. Is like, we mentioned Luke coming out of there, and he's like all definitely out of character, but Scotty wasn't very much affected.
Well, Scott,
like,
was also in there for a much shorter amount of time. And have you noticed no one has asked him so far, why he was there?
Yeah, but I took a look at the previews. It looks like we're going to be focusing a little bit on Scott and Lucy in this next week, so, or at least Monday's episode will, so maybe we'll get some answers then. Maybe.
Maybe.
Maybe. Although, I will have to say, when Victor came and picked up Robin, and he and Patrick had a moment alone, Patrick's like, you know what? You know what? I'm trusting you with her, man. You better make sure she comes back in one piece, or otherwise I'm going to come and dismember your ass.
Yes. That was pretty awesome.
Yeah. That is somebody who is very protective of his wife, and rightfully so.
Yeah. Well, he's leaving her in the care of a fucking Cassidine, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah,
that is not Nicholas or Sam or Alexis. Okay? So it's just, yeah.
That's more than a little nerve-wracking. Yeah.
Yeah, and if he did his homework and learned his history, this is one of the guys that tried to freeze the fucking world.
Yeah.
And he's trying to revive his sister-in-law and his nephew. Which makes me wonder, I'm just waiting for the time when they decide to try and bring back Nikos. That's something that needs to be done. They have to recast because the original actor died, but...
Aww.
But you know what? They recast for Stavros. They can recast for Nikos.
Yeah. Random trivia fact. The actor who plays Stavros now, he was totally in an episode of Touched by an Angel back in the day. I didn't recognize him at first. I only saw it on. I only figured it out once I looked on IMDb. But yeah, it's weird because when he was on Touched by an Angel, he was clean shaven.
Oh God, that would be weird. And here's another weird fact: when Stavros was originally on the show, like back in the 80s, he was clean shaven then. So apparently, he was cryogenically frozen and somehow grew a goatee.
Well, yeah, like you do, you know.
Yeah, which I think is just one of those things where it's like, one of those things that really does not matter in universe, you know, when you have to recast a character or whatever, because when Lucky was originally recast, he was first played by Jonathan Jackson, brunette.
Uh-huh.
And then he was recast with Jacob Young, a blonde. Nobody commented on the color of his hair. It was like, oh, hey, Lucky. You know, so I think that's what they're supposed to be going with. It's not really a major point of interest when talking about that particular character. And the goatee may be one of those. So it's like, I mean, if they bring back Mikos, he might have a goatee. Who knows? When Mikos was clean-shaven. In fact, all three of the original Cassanine brothers were clean-shaven. So far, Victor has not been clean-shaven, although he's not been dead. So he's actually been alive all this time. Yeah. So it would make sense if he had a goatee. But, you know.
Really, they all need goatees to signify them as the bad guys.
Even Helena. Give her a goatee.
Even Helena. That would not be out of place.
No. somebody needs to Photoshop that.
and then send it to us.
We'll put it on the show.
So, anyway, speaking of Victor Cassadine, at the top of the week, he cornered Obrecht, and... you know, he has the information about Cesar Faison, and he's like, I'll give it to you if you come with me. And she's like, hell no.
No, she's like, I got my own plans here, fuck off.
And he's like, fine, I will give it to you because I've always loved you, but may I please have a goodbye kiss? And she's like, whatever, okay.
And there you go, kiss. And even she's like, she looked a little dreamy-eyed even after that kiss. It's like,
she did a little bit.
Like, wow, wow. I remember that. Wow, he still got it. And then she reads what's in the file, obviously, and goes off to confront Anna.
And oh my god, the confrontation between Anna and Obrecht was fucking fantastic, in my opinion. Because they're both, like, brimming with hate for each other. And, you know, Obrecht is saying, you know, according to this file, no one has seen him since Spoon Island. You killed him, didn't you? And Anna's like, maybe I did, maybe I didn't. Boy, doesn't it really suck not to know if someone you love is alive or dead? To just sit there and wonder and just be tortured by it? You know, that's what you did to me about with Robin. And guess what? Now you get to... Yeah. Now you get to experience that. How's it taste, bitch?
Mm-hmm. And then Obrecht turns that around and makes the same claim back to Anna about Robin currently.
Yes.
Going off, not knowing whether or not she's going to survive or not, going into danger. Which, Anna doesn't show it to Obrecht, but after Obrecht leaves the room and stands outside of the door, and she hears Anna just rage and just... throw stuff everywhere.
Yes.
Well, I say throw stuff everywhere, but she really just, like, knocked everything off of her desk, and Obrecht is like, I got given up on her.
It was just kind of funny. It was just amazing to just see the two of them just rip each other's hearts out.
Yes. That is... Oh, God. Ah, oh, those two. Oh, so where else have we not gone? Let's see, Rick Lansing, he's running around, you know, seeing people. He's doing his I'm Back in Town tour, went to go visit Elizabeth, caught up with her a little bit. And then AJ gets brought in because, you know, he was shot. And Rick learns that Elizabeth and AJ had a thing for a while. And we learned that Elizabeth may still have feelings for AJ. It's, aww.
Which, you know, it's not surprising.
Yeah.
You know, she keeps, you know, telling everyone that, you know, her thing with AJ was more about fixing him, and I'm calling bullshit on that. I think that's how she's justifying breaking it off with him.
Yeah, which hey, you know, at his bedside, she was like, I didn't know how to be there for you and all of that, and confessing all of this to him. Right there when Michael's out of the room, and it's like, yeah, your summation of that, definitely.
Yeah, and, you know, it's kind of funny because before AJ came in, Rick was asking Elizabeth out and being all like, you know, I know it didn't work out when we were married, but hey, let's give this a try again, which is kind of funny because that's basically, like, variation on the same line that Luke gave to Tracy when he was asking her to marry him.
Yeah. I see Luke, you know, out of character moments in anything, I can see him, you know, wanting the same thing with Tracy. You know, in character or out of character, so... That wasn't really a hint to me. If that was supposed to be a hint that he was out of character, then it was lost on me, because I could totally have seen him do that.
As a side note, the actress who plays Tracy, like, I got such a kick out of her in that proposal scene, mm-hmm. because Luke asks her to marry him, and she's like, no, and then she's like, you know, kind of interrogating him about why the hell would you want to, you know, make that same mistake again, and he's, you know, giving this really heartfelt speech, and the whole time she is just like irritatedly eating grapes and not looking at him, and
yes,
it was just such a fantastic bit of acting, and just totally Tracy, and I loved it.
And of course, you can't dismiss Luke's look on Luke's face when she initially told him no. It looked like a little kid whose puppy dog just died.
I was like, no, Luke, no.
I mean, granted, he had to lie about going to find Sonny in order to get the ring and surprise her, which, yeah, he admitted, and he fessed up and owned up to it. But it's like, eeh. Yeah, and speaking of Sonny going to Michael, of course, you know, he's at the hospital, you know, waiting on his dad, you know, keeping vigil. And of course the brothers, you know, he and Morgan, they have a moment, and it was awesome and sweet. And even Carly is like, you know what, he's not my favorite person, but I don't want him dead. You know, I do not want him dead.
Yeah.
You know, and then Sonny comes in. And I don't remember if it was on the show or if I'm remembering from the previews, but Carly, after seeing Sonny's attitude towards AJ when he gets there, she's like, you shot him, didn't you?
Yeah, that was in the show.
Yeah.
And I was like, how the hell did she figure that out?
I mean, one could argue that she has known him for and been close to him for such a long time that it's just one of those things she can tell just on his based on his mannerisms. And all of the other knowledge that she has about him and AJ. You know, so that is where I'm getting it.
Uh-huh.
To be completely honest with you. But, you know, who knows? I could be right.
I don't know, but that was a great moment when he's like, what?
And I'm sitting there, I'm like, oh, yeah. Yeah, Carly is... again, Carly is not my absolute favorite character, but when she gets it right. And it's just, yeah. She is not stupid.
No, she is not.
Usually not stupid. And she and Elizabeth have this conversation about how she didn't understand how Elizabeth could support AJ when she did and all of that. And then Elizabeth turned it right back around and said, you know what, same thing could be said about you and Franco. And Carly just said,
and Carly's,
you
know
what?
Like, yeah, I really liked that Carly was like, you know what, you're right, I accept that. And like, that is very mature of you, Carly.
Yes, point for Carly there. Definitely, major point there. Oh God, how many, who else have we not discussed this week?
Let's see, so, Morgan, it turned out, was going to check up and see if Ava was back, when he found the cops in her lobby, and once he found out that it was AJ that had been shot, the first thing he did was go straight to Sonny and ask him, did you do this?
Yeah, which, hey, smart kid. Yep. He's getting smarter. He's getting there.
Yes. and meanwhile, you know, Sean had been at Kelly's, and he and TJ have this talk where he, you know, TJ is really upset because Alexis is not letting TJ and Molly see each other at all, which I think is more than a little extreme.
It is. I mean, and people even call her out on the show and lampshade everything. It's like, Alexis is so progressive about so many other things. And then this, and she's, like, you know, really, really overprotective.
Yeah, and I loved, you know, and Molly has just kind of had a gutful of it because, you know, she comes home a little bit late because she was doing her SAT prep class, and Alexis is freaking the fuck out, and, you know, she's like, where were you? And Molly's like, I was having sex with TJ.
I have to admit, I love that.
And, you know, and just kind of keeps twisting the knife, and, you know, Molly confronts her, and she's like, this is, you know, you trust me in every other aspect of my life, why not this? You know, we weren't, you know, doing anything in the heat of the moment, we planned it, we're ready, we love each other, we've been together for a long time, we know this is what we want to do, you know, you saw that, you know, we had a condom, we booked a room, you know, we were being responsible. Obviously, this is not about us. This is about you. And Alexis just is like, nope, 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 nope.
Yeah.
And she's, basically she tries to come back with, I'm your mother, that's why. And Molly's like, bullshit.
Because that is the phrase you use when you can't think of any other good reason.
Exactly. And so, you know, when Julian's arrested, he calls Alexis. And, you know, while she's gone, TJ comes over to see Molly. And they're just kind of commiserating. And Molly's like, I am sick to fucking death of this. And then she gets this idea. She's like, you know, my mother isn't the only parent I have in Port Charles now. And so she calls her dad. And I absolutely loved the scene between Rick and Alexis later, because Alexis tries to talk to Julian, and Julian's like, you know, I have an alibi, but I can't tell you what it is unless it's protected by attorney-client privilege. And Alexis is like, I'm not going to take you on as a client unless you tell me what your alibi is, so I guess we're at an impasse.
Yep, but she does refer him to Rick.
And, you know, so she goes home, and I don't know if she had already called Rick or what, but he comes by, and he thinks they're there to talk about Molly. And when he figures out that they're not, he's like, okay, you know what? And they go around and around. And she says some pretty awful things to him. And you can almost see the moment when he's like, you know what? Fuck being polite. because he was kind of trying, and she was really being mean to him, which, granted, from the sound of things, the way she talks about him, he probably has earned, but he hasn't been a dick to her yet. This time.
Yeah.
And so
unless you want to count him siding with Molly on the whole sex issue being a dick.
Yeah.
Then yeah. But discounting that, and even that is based on who you're talking to. But yeah, anyway.
Yeah. So just as a parting shot, as he's leaving, he's like, oh, by the way, Molly asked if she could live with me, and I said yes. Thanks for the referral. Bye.
Yes!
Like, I was sitting in my chair cheering as Alexis was like, what?
That was hilarious.
And the next thing, you know, Alexis is, you know, leaving Molly messages like, this is the woman who birthed you and raised you. Could you please call me back? And I'm like, yes, I'm sure that is going to get through to her. Yes. By all means, go with.
Yeah, it's just woman, cool your tits, cool them off a bit, you know. Give in, let Julian clear out the cobwebs a little bit, and you'll be all right.
And it's kind of funny because you know, TJ and Sean were talking, you know, earlier, and you know, Sean was talking about how, you know, Alexis seemed to be getting kind of cozy with Julian, and saying flat out, if that's the case, she's one hell of a hypocrite, because, you know, she broke up with him for being Sonny's enforcer, and yet here she is jumping in, you know, possibly jumping into bed with Julian fucking Jerome.
Yeah, not just a mob boss, but a very ruthless mob boss at that.
Yeah.
A lot more ruthless than Sonny ever has been. I mean, like, Sonny has had his ruthless moments, but Julian is worse.
You know, if you looked up hypocrisy in the dictionary, I don't know if you would see Alexis's picture there first or Anna's, because they're both pretty equally awful at this point in that department. But seriously, Alexis has had 3 children by 3 different mobsters.
Yes.
And she's trying to take the moral fucking high ground with Sean? I'm like, what the hell?
Yeah. Although it could be argued that at least at the time she was with them, they did not directly kill anybody. Directly.
Woo-hoo?
Yeah, I know. I could see that being used as a justification. Which, right or wrong, that would be... I think that would be used. Sean would be directly responsible for taking somebody's life. Again.
Well, it's not like Sonny and Julian haven't directly taken lives. I mean, even if Alexis doesn't necessarily know about it, not to mention, as I recall, when they were having their fights, Sean brought up that Alexis killed Christina's first husband.
Mm-hmm.
In cold blood.
Yeah, that's right. I think she had run him over with a car and then just, like, hit and run or something like that.
Yeah.
I think it was. I mean, granted, the guy, from what I've read, he was a bit of an abusive asshole towards Christina anyway. But yeah. Still,
but
she still killed him
still
in cold blood.
It still makes her one hell of a hypocrite. And then, you know... And even Molly threw that in her face. She was like, you know, you were having sex at my age, you know,
yeah.
And I'm being a hell of a lot more responsible than you ever were.
Yeah.
So,
which, of course, Alexis doesn't want to hear that. I don't think many parents want to hear that. But sometimes they just need to. Which, you know, yeah, it causes fights, sure, whatever, but you know what?
Oh.
You gotta hear it.
And when she and Rick were having that argument, he kept, you know, saying, you know, you got pregnant in the back of, you know, a Pinto or something else, and she kept correcting him, and it was a Camaro.
Yes. That was a neat little running gag.
Like, it's really important to her that it was a cool car and not a piece of crap car that she got knocked up in at the age of 16 while drunk with someone that she didn't know.
Indeed. It's like, really?
What? That is the detail that is important.
Yes. Oh God. I have to admit, I'm still high on Rick's parting shot there.
Yes.
Oh, this is gonna be so much fun to look at and watch. You know, smack Alexis down a little bit, because it's like, yeah, for this situation, like I said earlier, she is progressive in most other things. I mean, her speech to Julian about whether or not, you know, if her kids were gay, she would still support them, she would still love them, etc., etc., etc. That is awesome. And then you have this, where she's freaking out about Molly possibly having sex.
And you know what the thing that makes her even more of a hypocrite is, you can bet if it were anybody else's kids, she would be supporting the kids. And
probably
just saying, as long as they're safe, you know, just let them, you know, you know, make sure that they're being responsible. But otherwise, kids will be kids.
Yeah, but not her kid.
No, not Molly. No.
I don't even know if she went through this when Christina was coming of age like this. I really don't know. And who knows, maybe part of her reaction may be stemmed from something that happened when Christina first had sex, or she started having sex. You know, because like we mentioned, I think the guy's name was Kiefer, I think it was. And he was an abusive asshole towards her. That may be part of Alexis's, you know, freaking out, you know? It's like, hey, you know what? This is, I don't want the same thing to happen to Molly, which is understandable, but she is taking this way over, way, way, way over the line to the point where she is looking like a hypocrite.
Yes.
Even more so than she is for, you know, getting, you know, dumping Sean and about ready to jump in bed with Julian.
Yes.
Oh. And then, and speaking of Julian, he and Rick do meet up at the, you know, I think they ended on him and Rick meeting up at the jail.
Oh, but before Rick came in, Carlos.
Mm-hmm.
Carlos came to see Julian, and Julian is trying to get Carlos to be a spy for him against Ava.
Mm-hmm.
Because Julian's sure that this must have had something to do with Ava. And he's not wrong. He just, you know, can't prove it right now. And it's really interesting to see the loyalties at work here because Carlos knows the whole story.
Yeah.
Ava has already sat down and told him exactly what happened with Connie. And he was, you know, the one who broke in to try and kill AJ on her behalf.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't tell Julian any of this and tries to, you know, beg off of, you know, going against Ava. And, you know, Julian pulls the whole, you know, I sign your paychecks thing. And if you don't do what I say, then we're going to have a problem. And it's hard to tell if Carlos is actually taking that seriously.
Yeah. Which, you know, I can understand why Carlos would be a little hesitant to tell Julian, especially considering the fact that they're at the police station in the jail.
Yeah.
That's a little understandable, you know, a little bit. If they were, like, at the docks or something, or somewhere where they could be expecting to not have people peeping in on them or what have you, that would be a different story, I think.
I don't know. They've never seemed to care before.
True. But who knows? We'll see how that all plays out. Oh god, what else have we missed from this past week?
Nathan is still he came back and talked to Anna and he's like, you know, Dr. Clay is killed again, and Anna's like, okay, you know what? You really kinda need to back the hell off. And, you know, your single-minded determination to find Dr. Clay guilty of something, it might be clouding your judgment.
Just a little bit.
You know, have you considered it might have been Ava? You know, she was in New York at the same time. And, Nathan is like, why are you so eager to, you know, find Ava guilty of something? And I'm like, you know, she's kind of not, you know, Anna hasn't really been gung-ho against Ava.
Yeah, which is kind of, I don't know if it's weird so much or if it's just Anna trying to do her job and keeping a level head.
It's just, you know, Anna isn't trying to go after Ava. Ava's name just keeps popping up in a lot of investigations.
Yeah.
Because Ava did a lot of, you know, illegal shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'm gonna call it right now, Ava Jerome is a goddamn godmoder. She is. I mean, it's like, you think that she's gonna get her comeuppance, and no. You know, like this week with AJ. Yeah, she's gonna get her comeuppance. Nope, Sonny comes in and shoots him. You know, it's like, convenient. Oh my god.
Yeah.
And then, of course, until the reveal that the WSB has apparently infested the building that Nina was at, I was sitting there thinking, okay, Ava had something to do with this and conveniently had Nina either killed or moved, you know, somehow, and of course she gets away with it. It's just, really? You are Ava Jerome, you're a godmoding bitch, and you are clearly a creator's pet, or a writer's pet at the very least. Because I don't think the creators are actually working with the show anymore. I think they're probably long gone.
And it's going to be really interesting to see where this goes from here. Because, you know, Ava kept going on and on about how, you know, if anyone finds out that Sonny shot AJ, then, you know, they're both going down. But that's not necessarily true. And she has a major, major piece of leverage over Sonny now.
Yeah.
Because if he does anything, all she has to do is say, I'm gonna tell Michael that you shot AJ.
Yeah, she could do that, and this being Ava, being a writer's pet, she could do that and probably survive. Oh,
you know,
dear.
It's really gonna be interesting to see where this goes, because at this point, you know, the only things Ava seems to care about are, you know, self-preservation and Morgan.
Mm-hmm.
And there are very, you know, very few other things she gives the slightest shit about. Maybe money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just maybe. Oh, wow. So have we missed anything else from this week? Let's see. We've covered AJ. He's still in the hospital. Michael's with him. Elizabeth is apparently coming back around to AJ, realizing, yeah, all those justifications, bullshit.
Yeah.
You know, Carly got some points this week. Go, Carly.
Carly's on a roll after, you know, bitching out Robin last week and that, you know, conversation with Elizabeth this week. I'm like, yeah, you know, I could get to like Carly if she keeps being, you know, cool and not, you know, a bitch. Or at least my kind of bitch.
There you go.
I should clarify that.
Oh, God. So let's see. Rick is poking around, just asking questions, and of course rubbing the fact that Molly, you know, he agreed to let Molly move in with him in Alexis's face, which was epic.
Yes. It's going to be interesting to see where that goes too, because, you know, they don't seem to really know each other that well. I mean, everyone keeps saying that he's been gone for 5 years.
Yes. And even with that said, I do believe there has been some lines of dialogue where Molly has communicated with
him. Yeah.
So it's not like they don't talk at all.
And so,
you know,
it's going to be interesting to see what kind of father he is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, at the very least, it's, you know, it seems like letting Molly and TJ just see each other was probably one of the things that Molly asked for and one of the things he probably agreed to.
Yeah, because it's like, yeah, you know what, I was 16 once, so was your mother. We were both young and, you know, as I think my father had once said, young, dumb, and full of cum. And of course, you know, it's gonna happen. Just be mature about it. Be ready, you know. And Molly and TJ obviously are. So, you know, hey, there you go.
Yep.
And we also learned that Silas and Sam kick all kinds of ass.
Yes, they do.
And somebody is stalking them.
Dun, dun, dun.
Watch the point of view shot be somebody like fucking Delia or something.
Well, you know, if it hadn't been, you know, before she was started heading back into town, back into New York, I would assume that it would be Ava, but she wasn't there yet, so.
Yeah. and speaking of traveling time, there's somebody on one of the boards, actually one of the Facebook groups that I post to about General Hospital, mentioned that, you know what, it's possibly not Rick who is the partner for Julian, simply because how the hell could he get from the docks to the hospital that fast?
You know what? Yeah. Everybody seems to teleport in this show, so I don't really. Yeah.
So, you know, except when you have to go to New York City.
Yes. Then it only takes five minutes. So.
Yeah. You know, and of course there always has to be passage of time from here, from point A to point B every now and then. That's fine, you know, because you can't just have every second of every day. I mean, that would get kind of tedious. And plus, sorry, I don't want to see some of these guys taking a shit. I just don't want to see that.
Gomer.
Seeing some of them have sex, that might be an interesting thing.
But we get to see that all the time.
No. I mean, see them have sex. Yeah. But then that wouldn't be a soap opera. That would be more of a porno.
Just a little.
Yeah. You know what I'm surprised they haven't made? The General Hospital porno parody.
That probably exists and we just don't know about it.
Maybe not. Maybe if Josh Hadley or Brad Jones are listening and they know about it, they could let us know. So, yeah, I think, and of course, Luke is out of character. What the fuck, Luke? What the fuck? Oh. Yeah, it's just, oh dear. But with that, I think that's about it. We're about out of time for this week. And knowing how I tend to ramble with my outro. thank you guys for listening. If you want to find me on the social media, you can find me on Twitter at Gomer21XX. You can also find me on Tumblr at Gomer21XX. And you can find my material on nerdvice.com and rtgomer.com. And of course, check out my Patreon page if you like the show, if you like the stuff that I do, and you want to support. Patreon's the best way to do it. I am looking to, you know, use that to help upgrade some equipment. As you can tell, it's not the best. But the more people that are actually able to patronize and actually pledge money to me and to the site, because they kind of both intertwine in the same thing on the Patreon page, because some of the goals up there are, one of the which is, you know, getting the unlimited space upgrade for the site. It is WordPress based, and with unlimited space, I could upload some of my other videos that I really don't feel comfortable putting on YouTube without a problem. So, and those are basically like older reviews and everything, because we know how YouTube is with the whole, you know, DMCA takedown notices and everything. Yeah, luckily they have not been hitting my Pokemon Quartz videos. but then again, it's also a ROM hack, so I guess that's the thing there. But again, if you want to check me out on Patreon, it's patreon.com/gomer21XX. If you want to donate some money, and it's a monthly thing, so if you pledge, like, you know, $10 a month or whatever, then that's how much will be there. And of course, if you pledge $20 or more per month, you will get ad space on my website, rtgomer.com, which is a better deal than most of the ad revenue prices, ad site prices, or whatever that I've seen around here. I checked out the Cinema Snobs, and it was like, yeah, that's a little pricey for me. So $20 a month, just flat ad space. And if you have something that you want to put on the site, you know, like you know, for your advertisement, fine. Of course, there are, you know, there's like the no illegal stuff or whatever, of course. And of course, if you just have an idea and you need somebody to do a graphic, let me know and I'll take care of that for you free of charge to you. I might be out of money, but that's okay. It's worth it. So yeah, that's about that. Where can we find you, Namio?
You can find me on Twitter at Naomi Washburn. You can find me on Tumblr. It's Namio's Corner. And you can find me on Etsy at Namio Stained Glass. Oh, and also, of course, the fabulous rtgomer.com. Can't forget that.
Yes. And of course, we can. And it's also running in the family, because we can find your dad on there, too.
Yes, you can. Which occasionally you will hear him make comments, because he watches the show with me.
Yes. I think one of these weeks we need to have, like, both of you on the show at the same time.
Yeah, we talked about that, and we were trying to figure out the logistics of, like, both of us being able to hear without having the mic, you know, the speakers in the background, which we could probably figure it out if we put our minds to it. It's just a matter of putting our minds to it.
Well, yeah. But, you know, all you need is line splitter and another set of headphones. That's all you need.
That is way too, makes too much sense. Stop with your logic. It is frightening. Frightening.
You know, that's what the GOP is saying, that's apparently. Mm.
Topical!
Yes, very topical. But if you want more topical stuff, go listen to Thespian Talk. I think this is going to go up, I think, Tuesday. I've recorded this and Thespian Talk on the same night. So this should be up Tuesday. So by now you should have heard the most recent Thespian Talk with the cat. Yes, a little plug for my other show. But for now, we're going to get out of here. Again, thank you guys for listening. And until next time, this is Gomer the Ranting Thespian with Namio signing off.
The Port Charlie Podcast is an RT Gomer Productions presentation. Check us out at rtgomer.com.